Welcome to Networking RX, a podcast devoted to helping business professionals like you enhance your networking skills in order to become more proficient, giving and receiving quality business referrals, and improving the overall quality of your life and the lives of those around you. The Networking RX podcast is a production of AmSpirit Business Connections, an organization whose mission is to empower business success through networking.
I tell people all the time that I don't want to say my kids have it made, but they certainly have a leg up. I was 35 years old before I realized really what this networking thing was all about. I was just all about accumulating degrees, doing well. I've got a law degree, I got an MBA, I got a CPA. Everybody would just be fighting all over themselves to work with me, and it wasn't the case. I know my kids have an advantage because they've seen that. They've seen that example, and I see them living it. I see them really understanding what a network can do for them. Maybe not as consciously as I do because I'm in it all the time, but they're miles ahead of where I'm at. They are just miles ahead of where I'm at. I'm guessing that today's guest, Larry Kaufman, probably could say something similar. He's the author of the best-selling book, The NCG Factor, a formula for building life-changing relationships from college to retirement. He's a connector, he's a giver, he's a rainmaker who lives his life to help other people succeed. He's the regional managing director Midwest region for the Midwest region of Jefferson Wells, which is a manpower group company. He's a senior level sales and operations leader and has been a globally published speaker trainer on LinkedIn for 15 years. He's an investor and an advisor to several local technology company, and he supports various local and national charities. Larry lives near Chicago, Illinois, with his wife and two wonderful kids who get to hear all about networking from Larry. Larry, welcome. Welcome to the program.
Frank, a pleasure to be here with less education, less certifications, and acronyms behind my name than yourself, but a pleasure.
Well, you do have an acronym here, and we're going to dive right into it. What is the NCG factor?
It's a formula for building life-changing relationships from college to retirement, and it's networking, connecting, giving. So that's all okay. Part of that process. And as you and I were talking previously, you know, that in our day in college, networking wasn't our thing. And I think that we're able to bring our knowledge today to those kids that are going to college and in college and beyond college.
Yeah. I don't know if they, well, I know in my day, they didn't teach networking. They talked about it. They gave it lip service. Yeah, you should get out there and network. You should get to know people. But my theory on it is that professors really don't do it. The educators really don't do it. They're kind of on campus in a department, even smaller colleges, like where I went, Beloit College. It's like you didn't have to hunt down work, right? It's a different world.
It is. Very different. But that was the intent of the book, to bring that to the kids now. So, you know, reflecting upon my life, yeah, I didn't have that edge. No one taught me networking. I didn't think about it. I didn't think about putting people together. I didn't think about any of those things. I just wanted to have fun.
Yeah, no, there was a time, you know, this is episode 690 something, maybe 680 something. I'll have to look. Doesn't matter. I have a lot of episodes. And there was a time when I was interviewing people. And the question I always asked was, if you could do it all over again, if you could go back and talk to that 18-year-old self, what would you tell that 18-year-old self? And it was a consistent answer, which is probably the reason I stopped asking it. I was hoping to get something other than what I kept getting. And what I kept getting was, I would tell my 18-year-old self, you know, to really dial into getting to know the people around where I went to college. One of my friends, Tom Anderson, he's a franchisee in my business. He says, you know, I went to the College of Worcester, which is in Ohio, he said, I didn't realize till 10, 15 years after I left campus that I was in school with the sons and daughters of CEOs and movers and shakers, and I did nothing with it, you know? He had fun, and it wasn't a total debacle, but he realizes he missed a real opportunity. And it sounds like what you're trying to do with your book and your talks is prevent that.
Really, you're correct. You know, it's rare that you find the younger generation has actually embraced networking. I do have a friend, and his son actually, his coach and mentor was his ex-girlfriend's father, who was a successful CEO. You don't see that often.
No.
But you're right. You know, when you look around the people that you went to school with, and they're, you know, I joke, you know, like, hey, how do you network when you're, you know, leaving college? Well, maybe some of your friends, you know, their parents, you go to their houses, nice homes and lake homes and nice cars. Ask the questions, what do your parents do? And, you know, just some of the kids today aren't wired that way. We got to get them thinking about asking those questions and learning more and cultivating those networks. And I'm hoping that's what the NCG factor can do, along with me behind it.
I don't know about you. I won't put you on the spot, but I will tell you that I'm always happy to help, like, one of my kids' friends. It doesn't happen all the time, but occasionally somebody will reach out and it's like, hey, how can you help me? What can you show me on LinkedIn? You know, that's usually it. And I'm always happy to help. I think what that, and I don't think I'm unique in that. And what I guess I'm trying to get at is I really think kids need to have a conversation with people and just, you know, tell me about your journey, you know, ask that CEO, that person with the lake house, the person who's successful, you know, tell me about your journey and what are some of the things I could be doing? Who should I be talking to? I never really thought about that. I was like, oh boy, I just need to ask somebody for a job. And that would feel very uncomfortable, so I'm not going to do it. And I totally missed the mark. But, you know, with the NCG, is it Network, Connect, Give? Is that correct? Did I get that right?
It is, yes.
Yeah, where were you? Where were you in the 80s? You were probably still in junior high.
Yeah, well, you know, we're not far apart from each other, Frank. So where you were, I probably was there with you.
Yeah, it's... And I, you know, I applaud what you're doing. I don't know, you know, it's, the change is slow. People understand the whole notion of it's not what you know, it's who you know. But they don't really know how to, that's all they know. They don't know the ins and outs. So you go to your high school guidance counselor, and they're, you know, they're for the most part fixated on, we need to get you doing something so you are marketable skills so somebody can hire you. And that's the, you know, we're going to get you to college or maybe a trade school. And that's kind of I've got you a job or I got you into college. They're going to wipe their hands and say, okay, I'm done. And those are skills, which I would call give me a fish skills, right? Just, I'm going to get you into college. And what we need are people like you, like your book, that are teaching people how to fish, you know, not just how to get that first job and be done with it. But here's how you get a job, how you be successful, how you continue on using that same framework. You know, I'm willing to bet, I haven't got your book yet, I haven't read your book yet. I'm willing to bet that your book is timeless. Somebody picks it up 1,000 years from now, it still has a relevance to it. That's my guess.
It just may be in a different format.
Okay, there you go.
But no, I appreciate that. And I think it is. And I, you know, I wrote about LinkedIn in the book, but, you know, LinkedIn may not be around. I didn't put point click, just the premise of LinkedIn. I think LinkedIn will be around a long time as well. But I would say that I do actually talk to the kids in and going to college probably weekly. You know, the parents, I help a parent and it's like, you know what, my son or daughter, would you be willing to talk to him or her? And I do. I spoke to someone today. They didn't prepare. I said, so did you research me on LinkedIn? Did you? No, nothing. Just, you know, just took it for granted that someone's going to try to help them. Came ill prepared. I'm like, I said, it doesn't bother me as much, but most people will, that you're going to talk to a senior leader that's trying to help you find a job. I have a job already. I said, you don't.
Yeah.
So you've got to show up and be engaged and take the time. But I extended my knowledge on LinkedIn and networking and building relationships. So I think sometimes some kids take it for granted, but there are some I've spent time with, Frank, they're amazing. You know, they're just, they implement what I share. They read my book.
Yeah.
They can't get enough. And they're not salespeople. Some people think you need to network because you're going into a sales role. You're going to be a doctor. You're going to be an engineer, an attorney. It doesn't matter. You need to build relationships. And I also tell the folks that are more mature like you and I, we need to keep doing it because we have kids and they may need help, or our grandkids. Or so keep fostering those relationships. It's not always just about us. It's about others.
Yeah, no, I think that's a good point. People think of networking as this precursor to this ugly thing, sales. And in reality, we all sell, right? You sell yourself to get a job. You sell yourself to get work at that job, to get promoted, to get a raise. It's all selling. We sell ourselves in relationships. You indicated you're married 35 years. I mean, there was a sales job. I don't know who sold who, but somebody sold somebody 35 years ago.
I oversold.
Okay.
She wants to return, but it's too late.
Yeah. Oh, well. The warranty's expired.
That's right.
How do you become indispensable? Your company, clients, staff, the people in your life?
You know, I just presented to a group in transition today, and I said, even though you may be out of work, when you do land, you want to be indispensable, but you could be indispensable to your family, to your friends, in the business world. How do you become indispensable? It's by not leading with yourself. It's by learning about what makes Frank tick and why did Frank get a JD and a CPA and an MBA, and why has Frank written so many books that blow my mind? It blows my mind, right? But learning about the other person allows you to learn things about that person where you may be able to help that person, where they want to be on a podcast, or they have a child who is looking for an internship, or they have a sick family member or in need of a specialist that you could help with. Whatever it may be, you can provide that connection, that expertise, but by asking and learning and listening, you become more indispensable when it's, again, not about you, but learning about the other person. And then the word spreads. You know, Larry's that guy I go to. He can help me with this. And I get those calls from my staff, from my family, from others. The word spreads. Larry's the go-to. Well, that's what you want to be remembered as. And so in my company, I'm indispensable. At higher levels in a $20 billion company, well, that's a good thing. So I think it's taking the time to ask good questions and learn about people instead of showing up and throwing up. It's my own quote. I like sharing it. If you lead with yourself, you will leave with yourself. You like that one, Frank?
I do. That's the G. That's the giving part. Do you ever get pushback, especially from the in transition groups? I mean, people, geez, I have nothing. I don't have a job. I don't. And when you get to a certain level, it's not easy, right? I mean, when you're entry level, they're looking for people all the time. But when you start moving up into director roles and C-suite stuff, there aren't, it's musical chairs and there aren't many chairs left. So people feel like they don't really have anything. What's your response to that?
I think you do. You know what it is? It's sometimes just saying that you're there. How can I help you? And so I share those five words, how can I help you? The more people have to ask it. And even if you can't execute or you don't think you can, sometimes you'd be surprised. You know, some of these folks that are in transition that land 2 years down the road, I'm trying to help someone else get a job. And I see Frank is on LinkedIn, is connected to someone I'm trying to get a resume to. Frank, you heard me speak when you were in transition. Now you landed a year ago. Oh, I remember you, Larry. How can I help you? Can you help out a friend of mine? Yes. But it's just saying that phrase, how can I help you, goes a long way. And so many don't say it.
No. Yeah. You know, years ago, there was a gentleman who reached out to me and he was pushed into transition, as many are. And he was very open to me. And he said, you know, I see what you've done. I see you've networked. I was so busy being the person I was, being my job, that I didn't build a network. I didn't do the things I needed to do. And I'm behind the eight ball here, if you will. And I helped him and I said, well, you can't let this happen again. You need to do the things I'm doing for you, or somebody. And he didn't. He got back in the job. He got focused again. He's like, he was leading himself. And it happened again. And I'm not the one to say, well, I'm not going to help you this go around, but I certainly reminded him of that earlier conversation. I'm sure he wasn't happy to hear it, much like our kids aren't happy to hear the I told you so speech. But that's essentially what happened to him. And I think in listening to your whole notion about becoming indispensable, the reason he found himself indispensable was, or he found himself in transition, is he was dispensable at the company he was at. If he had done the things that you're talking about, they were going to be more likely to say, you know, we need to keep this guy around.
I think people who make themselves indispensable in a company, like if their role is going to go away or there's a shift in the business, I got to find a place for Frank or for Larry. I mean, they're phenomenal. Even though this isn't working out here,
yeah,
we can't lose that person. And so it's important to do that.
Yeah. When I started my career in public accounting, and there were the firm I was at was not very good at it, but there were other firms that were really good at placing people. In the public accounting world, it's up or out, and not everybody's going to be a partner. But there were some firms who were really good at recognizing this guy's not going to be a partner, or this person, I shouldn't say guy or gal, this person's not going to be a partner here, but they've got talent and we're going to try and place them with our clients. Because then all of a sudden we have an ally inside our clients, and we have an ally out there who's going to be talking kind about us. And when I was at the firm I was at, I'll leave names out of it, that was not the case. It's unfortunate. LinkedIn. What are some best practices that you talk to people about? You're talking to the young kid or the person in transition who, I run into this all the time, that just LinkedIn's not a priority for them. The priority is the 60 hours a week, whatever they're doing. What are some best practices you give people?
Well, I think best practices are for sure is building a profile, branding yourself. Because when you're working at a company or when you're not, you still have to brand yourself. When you're working at a company, brand your company, what you do, and reinforce some of the thought leadership coming out of that company. So making sure that you're out there liking and sharing some of the content, the thought leadership, and producing your own. But using LinkedIn as an opportunity to connect with your people from your accounting firm that you worked at before, Frank, in law school and undergrad and even grade school and high school.
Yeah.
And continuing to flourish that network, because you never know how, when, and where you're going to want to use that network of connections. And so I would say the other thing would be, you know, you're in a company where you're meeting with people internally, you get new staff, you meet with people from other areas of the business. I love looking on LinkedIn to see, oh, wait, who do we share in common? Frank, how do you know so-and-so? That's so strange. And, oh, I went to law school with that person. Oh, what a small world. And drawing those parallels, or seeing that we both support charities for autism or cancer research. I tell people, even internally, externally, look at people's profiles, who you share in common. It creates conversation and maybe opportunity to help one another. So it's really powerful. From a sales perspective, it's unbelievable. From a talent perspective, you could build your talent pipeline, you know, your succession plan.
Yeah, it's when I talk to people about LinkedIn, especially younger people, I say, you have no idea what kind of an advantage that is. I mean, think back to when you were trying to find a job or build your career pre-LinkedIn. You would go into meetings and you literally had to ask, okay, give me your background, because you couldn't look these things up. I'm sure you could, but it would just take a lot of work. You know, here it's like people just put out there, you know, here's the six jobs I had before, and this is what they're volunteering in. And, you know, you can look at their posts and see what they're involved in. What an advantage. It's, you know, back to your story earlier about somebody meeting with you and not even taking the time to do that.
It's so powerful. Even from a sales perspective, a person on my team wanted to get into a very large bank to a C-suite. And I looked up that C-suite person on LinkedIn, and I shared a lot of connections. I called only one, and I called up this gentleman. I said, how do you know this executive at this bank? Well, you know, we went to college together. We were roommates, and as couples, we're still friends, and we travel all the time. I said, could you make an introduction, like through email? He said, no. I said, why? He goes, no. He goes, I'm calling him up and telling him he has to meet with you.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah, and in our day, and if you're selling, oh my God, you know, I come from the world of cold calling. You know, that's where I cut my teeth. And, you know, there wasn't internet back then. We did have cars, everybody.
Yeah. And they weren't like the Flintstones. They drove just like
we
now.
We had cars. Yeah. Oh, yeah. We didn't have cell phones, though. That was not there yet. But
yeah.
No, it was, you know, different times, but I'm a cold caller that became a warm consultative kind of caller. But the LinkedIn is just, you know, everyone's so fortunate outside of sales, or just having that luxury where I'm meeting with you and I could look at all of your accomplishments that wouldn't be anywhere else on the internet. I know you have a website, Frank, but let's say you didn't.
Yeah. And
LinkedIn is such a great place to tell a story, and people that don't tell that story about themselves are doing themselves a personal disservice, because they're managers and leaders. They'll look on LinkedIn. Let me look at Larry. Oh, wow. It's impressive. I didn't know you do that.
Yeah. Well, and it's free. I mean, people
it's
can
free
pay
and paid, but you can do a lot for free. Yes.
Yeah. You can do a tremendous amount for free. I know some people out there, they talk on just all the free things you can do on LinkedIn. And it's amazing. Now you get out, you do a lot of speaking. You have the book, the NCG Factor. People listening, how can they help you? How can they get a hold of you? You know, obviously looking to get out and do programs and.
Well, they can find me on LinkedIn, of course. So I'm in Chicago.
I'm glad you're there.
They can find LinkedIn Larry on LinkedIn in Chicago, Larry Kaufman. And I do have also a website of my own that shares testimonials and speaking tracks, which is Kaufman-Larry.com. And those are, you know, of course, on Amazon, you could find my book, The NCG Factor.
Awesome. Well, I'll get that stuff in the show notes. I appreciate your time today. I appreciate you being on the program.
Frank, thanks for having me. Great to be a part of your show today. Thank you.
Thanks for joining us on the Networking RX podcast. Please put what you've learned into action today and let us know if you have questions, comments, or ideas for future topics. You can email them to us at podcast@amspirit.com. That's AmSpirit.com. Finally, so you never miss an episode, be sure to subscribe to the Networking RX podcast through iTunes, Overcast, or however you receive your podcasts. Now get out and network with someone.
The Networking RX podcast is the copyright production of AmSpirit Business Connection. All rights reserved.